Hey, everybody. What's going on, fellow dickheads?
How's everybody doing today? I'm feeling pretty happy.
Alex isn't here. She will be, but she's running quite late, so we're going to bust her ass.
Oh, and we're going to talk about her, too, real pretty bad.
We will definitely bust her tits about this one.
Oh, fucking unbelievable. So the story I got was that they had to get something together for a potluck dinner they're going to later. So apparently they started that at 1 o'clock so they could, I don't know.
They had to get stuff together at a potluck dinner?
For a potluck dinner.
They're
going to one afterwards. So she's bringing us food, apparently.
Oh, shit. Really?
I wish.
Are you serious?
No.
Oh, fuck. Well, then it's not worth it.
Right?
Well, our shows that we had before on, we had religion. We've talked about
Second Amendment.
We had singularity, the technological singularity in mathematics. Talked about quite a few things. This one, probably one of the more controversial subjects of all time. And it's actually been
in the news a lot lately.
At least on, social media, it's been on quite a bit. And a lot of scientists have been, you know, going back and forth, kind of talking about it. But we're going to be talking about the idea of a flat Earth.
That's right.
And with us today, we have Mark Sargent. Now, Mark, are you with us?
I am.
Hey, Mark, how's it going?
Pretty good.
Could you, just to start, because I don't know a whole lot. I know I kind of reached out to you. I forget how I came across you. I think on Twitter.
Pornhub.
Yeah.
Nice.
And I figured, you know, I heard that you were kind of prominent in this field. And I figured, okay, well, this is the guy to talk to. We'll talk to him. So
sure.
Could you give us a little bit of your background to at least get us started?
Yeah. I started out back in the day. I actually played video games professionally, believe it or not, for a small publishing house out in Boulder, Colorado.
You get paid for that?
There are a few people out there that actually get paid to do it, to play.
Get out of here. How much money can you make professional video gaming?
Well, when you're working for a company, it's different. It's not like you're a ringer that's playing competitively. That's different. That's usually a South Korean thing or an Asian thing. But when you're playing for your own house, you know, you're working for a video game producer and you guys are making games, you're getting paid to not only show off those games at conventions like E3 and Macworld and stuff like that, but you're also paid to play other people's games and let the publisher know what you think, you know.
I got you. So you're basically a tester, sort of speak.
Yeah.
Okay,
But
I was more than that, but yeah.
Yeah, more or less, but a ringer, kind of. So I'd make the games look better than they were when we were pitching them to certain people. Anyway, so after I was done with that, I taught proprietary software to different companies around the United States for about 20 years. And that's more or less what I did. That was mostly out in Boulder, Colorado, which was a lot of fun. And during that entire time, I've always been a conspiracy guy. Love conspiracies ever since JFK, the movie by Oliver Stone back in the 90s, and, you know, followed all the conspiracies and thought, it's like, some I liked, some I didn't like. But if you spend a lot of time with conspiracies, you have your favorites. And then I thought, okay, well, I've pretty much done it all. And I was getting kind of bored, so I was looking online, and everybody knows the worst conspiracy of them all, with a head and shoulders above the rest, is flat Earth, because it's dumb, it's stupid, it's ridiculous, can't be true, there's no way, it's the book on the shelf you never want to read, it's the DVD you're never going to watch, because we're all told since we're kids, you know, it's debunked to children. It's the only conspiracy I know that's debunked to children. So I take a look at it one day. I figure, you know, it's on my bucket list. I think I'll knock it out in a weekend, and it'll be, or less, just a couple hours, because there's got to be some obvious reasons why that there's no way. And I start pulling on some threads. And I initially got into it because I looked at a German guy's video who was talking about flights in the Southern Hemisphere. And he goes, look at all the stuff that goes from Southern to Southern, you know, like Africa to South America or South America to Australia. He goes, the connections don't make any sense. He goes, there's almost no direct flights. There's only like 5 direct flights in the entire Southern Hemisphere. Everything else bounces around the Northern Hemisphere. And I go, okay. He goes, the only way that could work is if the Earth was flat. You know, it was actually like a like the UN flag,
Can I interrupt you for a minute?
Sure.
All right. So you were talking about you're always been into conspiracies, and I'll be real honest, they intrigue me. Like I read into a lot of these. Mm-hmm. I've looked into the moon landing. Where do you stand on the moon landing, by the way? Happened or didn't?
No, couldn't. In fact, okay. And not only did it, this answered for me why it didn't happen. That was what's bugged me for 10 years.
Well, that was a big one for me.
Yeah.
I was actually, and I don't even think Mike knows this because Mike
you
and I.
You were on the moon?
No.
Oh.
No. I'm going to knock all you right. to the moon, Alice. Anyway, that was kind of one that I was on the fence for a little while. Honestly, I was kind of like, I watched all the documentaries. I read all the books and how the atmosphere, like they couldn't, you know, the Apollo craft could not possibly handle that atmosphere. It would have just melted up.
Yeah.
And as thin as it was made and as thin as their suits.
Handle what atmosphere?
Hold on.
Okay.
Let me just,
well, what do you
think? Out in the galaxy, the radiation. The radiation in the galaxy, not the atmosphere.
The Van Allen radiation belt.
Yes. Yeah. The radiation belt. So I'm looking at this and they show their suits and all this other stuff. And I'm kind of like, this is kind of intriguing.
Yeah.
And I get onto that. Yet the most simplest of backyard experiments can prove that we were there. You can actually bounce.
Well, if you have the equipment.
If you have the equipment.
Yeah, I mean, I watched the Mythbusters episode because they were trying to debunk the
whole... I didn't see that one.
Oh, you ought to watch it. They spent an entire episode on it where they went to an observatory and supposedly bounced a laser, even though beam dispersal is like 2 feet per mile, which means the beam, the amount of photons coming back would be negligible. But it doesn't really matter. Let me throw, since you're going to bring up the moon, let's get into the moon for a little bit.
Yeah, but not long.
The what?
Oh, that's all right.
But yeah, but not too long. But I'm
okay. Well, no. I'll give you a great question that I throw at scientists from time to time, which is it's a trap question. Because what you're talking, I know you said atmosphere, but it's really kind of like, you know, the conditions out there.
Right.
Which
the radiation
is,
belt.
Okay, the radiation belt. If the Van Allen belts were announced by 1959 in NASA, supposedly the deadliest things ever, you know, 60,000 miles thick. And Van Allen himself, you know, said, oh, yeah, we should never, ever go up there. And then, of course, Kennedy, a couple years later, says, no, we're going to go to the moon and we're going to, it's like, okay, so... We did round trips, Apollo 8 through Apollo 17. We won't count 9 because supposedly that didn't leave. Round trips through the Van Allen belts, and nobody died. Nobody got radiation poisoning. Nobody got cancer. In fact, there's 7 astronauts still alive from the Apollo series.
True.
Even now.
Which raises eyebrows, and I'm with you. But
yeah,
okay.
So what shielding exactly did you use? And it's a rhetorical question. There is no shielding. You can look at the specs yourself. It's just some aluminum and plastic and some little bit of metal here and there. But the only thing you can shield yourself from radiation is gold or lead. Lead we wear at the dentist's office. Gold is twice as dense as lead. And I'm going, okay, and here's where the trap question comes in. Is they're saying, well, okay, well, it's not that dangerous. In fact, Stanton Friedman told me that in an argument. He goes, well, they're not that dangerous. You know, he thinks he's a specialist in radiation. I go, okay, fine. Go to the NASA website, you know, nasa.gov. And in fact, you can type it into a search engine and look for a video called Orion Trial by Fire. And everyone knows, if you're into space, the Orion Project, the Americans going to Mars one day. And they made this video, won a local Emmy, I think down in Texas, where they shot this thing. And they said, well, yeah, the first capsules we're going to test for the Mars program are going to be unmanned because we can't figure out how to get past the Van Allen radiation belts. And they were very specific about this, you know, with graphics and spooky sound effects, like it was super deadly. I'm going, whoa. What do you mean you can't get past them? How is that even possible? You made this video in the end of 2014. You supposedly got past in the 60s. So unless you're going to tell me that our electronics are so far sophisticated now that we don't have shielding to protect them, which is a stretch. Why did you even make that statement? And this is a full NASA video on their website right now. Scientists have no answer to this whatsoever. In fact, Stanton just shut down as soon as I threw it at him.
So let me ask you another question. So is that part of your flat Earth theory, because we've never been far enough to see a round Earth?
No, it wasn't. In fact,
and what about satellites? Why can't satellites?
You got, unfortunately, and I hate to do this to people that are on there, because, and I know this isn't a call-in show, right?
No, okay. No, it's not.
Good, because the phone lines would just be blowing up at this point. People, would
yeah, I wouldn't be, answer them.
They'd be
fuck that people.
Losing it, because you got to give up everything: the Apollo program, the ISS, satellites. Well, satellites as far
iPhones.
As you know.
Cell phones, yeah, because cell phones. Well, no, how are cell phones going to work without your satellites?
A lot of I've talked to cell phone guys, the guys that configure the towers, and they say, look, everything is tower to tower, underground cables. I'm sorry, underwater cables. And there is stuff up there, no question. There is absolutely stuff up there. But as far as these small objects that are orbiting the Earth, probably not. Not on their own power. It seems that, it could be balloon based. Look up the NASA balloon programs, which has been.
And how the fuck do they stay up there?
Balloons, probably. If they're balloons. even if they're satellites at all, look up the NASA balloon projects that have been going on.
Air, pop, break,
yeah,
whatever.
Eventually,
and then
eventually.
Shit crashes to the Earth.
So what about the International Space Station? Are you saying that I've seen that thing?
But it doesn't matter if you've seen it. What you got?
What do you
look,
mean? It doesn't matter if I've seen it.
He's talking about through a telescope.
What I'm talking? Yeah. What you see in the telescope? Can you see the people inside there? Because you really ought to watch the interior footage. In fact, type in something as simple as ISS hairspray. Well, check that out if you get a chance.
What you're saying, though, mm-hmm. is that this conspiracy runs so deep that all of these people, all these astronauts, everybody who works for NASA, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, everybody is able to keep a secret.
No, not at all. Not at all. As a matter of fact, I lived next to one of the most prominent NASA wrench turners there was, a guy named Wayne Ottinger. He was like the NASA garage mechanic, knew all the astronauts on first name, would get phone calls all the time, worked on Mercury and Gemini and Apollo. He knew nothing. This thing's big enough that the only guys that need to know would be the telemetry guys. And the guys.
This is the thing that I've heard in regards to the moon landing, is so much of it is so departmentalized that nobody knows the big picture. And those who do are either dead or silent.
Well, it's just like school shooting, the one that took place on the East Coast. I forget.
Sandy Hook.
It's just like things like that, where when it happens, you see it on TV, you hear a piece of a story, not everybody gets the entire picture, and then they start piecing stuff together, and then they say, oh, it never really happened. But then you talk to a parent who lost a kid.
Right.
And we know somebody who knows those people, works over there, and sure. Yeah, those kids
I actually
died.
Met two of the parents.
Yeah.
Real quick, again, and I know we don't have, I don't know how long you want to go with this. When it comes to ISS, look at a couple things. Don't look at the exterior footage as much as you should look at the interior footage. And I'm not kidding you when I say that there is the production value on the interior of that thing has been horrible. And I don't know why they have spent such little time trying.
You mean on a space station?
On the International Space Station. The hairspray thing is just brilliant, because what they figured out was, yeah, you can simulate zero G and one of the vomit comet planes. They're pretty easy to come by, but you only have it for a limited time, so you have to extend that here and there. But if you're going to do the vomit comet, you have a problem, especially if you're going to leave the women with long hair. Because a woman with long hair is sort of, and you can see this in other footage where they're actually doing zero G, when you take people up in zero G planes, a woman's hair reacts, it flows with her. So when she moves to the left, her hair trails behind her. But that can't happen on the ISS because it's perfectly stationary. There are no jarring movements. And you don't, it's not like there's no turbulence if you believe in the ISS. So instead of putting a hat on them or cutting their hair real short, what they did was they permed their hair. They put it straight up like the Bride of Frankenstein.
How do you know that?
You can see it.
How do you know they did that, or if the people themselves haven't chose that to their hair and in their eyes?
It's
when
I'm sorry.
When you're in constant free fall, that's the hair I would expect.
You got to watch it. Maybe I'm not doing it justice, but in describing it to you over the radio, but it is stiff and straight up. There is no flow to it at all. I mean, it looks like you could bounce a ball off of it.
Even if, okay, and yeah. Let's just say that it's all faked. All these people that work for NASA and JPL, they're all just lying, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We also then would have calculus would be wrong. Mathematics would be wrong. Because you can test things on Earth that, according to the laws of physics, according to Newton's laws of motion, that should only occur if the Earth is like any other planet. But we're saying that no, that's all bullshit. Newton's laws are crap. I mean, you can go down that rabbit hole a long way, and you find out that it's just none of that holds water.
So to speak, no play on words there, which some things you were saying are accurate and some aren't. There are things that we can test on the ground. In fact, it's one of those things that we kind of fell for the trick, which is you can test things on the ground very easily, like water is wet, fire burns, drop something, it falls to the ground, that appears to be gravity. But when it comes to the shape of the Earth,
Foucault's pendulum.
Foucault's pendulum ways that cannot be simulated in any way, shape, or form.
I can do a Foucault's pendulum at the equator, and it will react differently than it will at my latitude here in Chicago.
So you also believe in the Coriolis effect, and that water drains differently in the northern and southern hemisphere?
No, I never. No, not at all. I mean, I don't know anything about the water draining, but the Coriolis effect. If you were to kick a football from a, you know, there's a slight change in its trajectory, mm-hmm. depending on what direction, you know, if you're kicking north to east, south, you know what I mean. So
shouldn't golf have to also apply to them? Okay,
sure, depending on the direction that they're hitting.
Long range snipers should also take this into account.
Okay, just to speak from somewhat military background, mm-hmm. long range snipers do take that into consideration. They take a lot of things into consideration. However, they're shooting at, you know, 300 to 400 yards. They're not shooting at 6 miles.
Quicker.
Yeah. And it's hard to, I mean, the velocity of a bullet is not going to change. It moves a lot different than a football or a golf ball.
Sure.
So, I mean, it takes a lot to change the trajectory of a bullet. However, they take a lot of things into consideration, and that would be one of them over a long distance shoot. However, they very seldom shoot more than 300, 400 yards.
Okay, so here's something I wanted to, because I just looked up the Van Allen, something that was said. Okay, an explanation is given by astronomer Phil Platt in 2001 in an article. He said that the Van Allen belts are a region above the Earth's surface where the Earth's magnetic field has trapped particles of the solar wind. An unprotected man would indeed get a lethal dose of radiation if he stayed there long enough. Actually, the spaceship traveled through the belts pretty quickly, getting past them in an hour or so. There simply wasn't enough time to get a lethal dose, and as a matter of fact, the metal hull of the spaceship did indeed block some of the radiation. Now, had the Apollo astronauts been in the way of a strong solar flare event while on the lunar surface, it would have been a different story. Protected only by their spacesuits, they could have received a lethal dose of solar radiation very quickly as a cloud of particles swept past the Earth and the Moon. Luckily, that didn't happen, but it was an occupational hazard.
Sure.
Just one of the things there.
No, I gotcha. But you gotta remember, science is going to have to explain it because nobody died. What, an hour isn't enough for a lethal dose? And you gotta remember, they are traveling, if you believe in the story, they're traveling slower on the way back than they were going out. Fine, if you want to say that you're doing 18,000 miles an hour, which supposedly is the top speed as you're leaving Earth.
No, well, 18,000, that's getting you, that will put you into, that'll get you escape velocity. But then if you go around the Earth 2-3 times in order, you're stealing and robbing energy from the Earth's gravitational pull. Mm-hmm. You're essentially then slingshotting out. You're going much faster than 1,800 miles per hour.
18,000.
18,000 miles per hour.
Okay, even if that was true, on the way back, you would have to slow way, way down, which means you're spending more time in the belt. And as far as what he's saying about, there's no shielding. Well, There's no shielding on
this
craft.
Well, why would you have to slow way down? If you're going around, the moon also has gravitational pull. Less so, yes, but you're still robbing energy from it as you slingshot around it towards back to Earth. And then once you reach the Lagrange point, basically Earth is also pulling you towards it. So you're speeding up as you're approaching Earth. That's before
you reach. You got to break eventually, like anything. You've got.
Sure, you do. That's why you turn around and you do the braking.
I got a question. Just to kind of jump in here. First of all, say hello to Alex. Alex has joined us now.
Hey y'all.
Hey there.
Oh, wait. Her microphone was off. Mark.
Sorry,
Alex. Alex,
can you hear me now?
I could hear.
Hey, y'all.
Okay, so she sounds much better than she did in the beginning of the show, right? So anyway, I got.
Ziggy's here too.
We got Ziggy.
I got Ziggy off. Hey, yeah. Mike, work Ziggy. Okay, Ziggy has a question or two. I don't know if he will.
But I have a question.
What's going on, Ziggy?
Just to simplify this. Okay.
Yeah.
If you were talking to say a 10-year-old,
yeah.
How come the sun is round? How come the moon is round? How come I can go purchase, a relatively decent telescope and see planets that are round all around me? Explain eclipses. How do those fucking happen? How do I get a lunar eclipse? How do I get a solar eclipse?
How do you get a blood moon?
How do I get a what?
A blood moon.
Oh.
Atmosphere. Because a blood moon can't be possible because there's no Earth between the sun and the moon if it's
sure
on a
You're looking through atmosphere.
What?
You're looking through the atmosphere of the Earth. That's how you get colors when the sun sets. That's how you get
Blood moon. Blood moon. When happens when the Earth comes between the sun and the moon produces a blood moon? It doesn't really matter. The answer to his question is, because you were saying, well, if I get a telescope and I look up in the sky.
Yeah, well, everything else, every other planet, every other moon, every other star, every other anything
appears,
that we can visually see with a telescope.
Got it.
And now you can't conspiracy theory me on a telescope. You're not selling me a bullshit telescope.
No.
I mean, the telescopes aren't rigged. So I'm looking through a telescope and I'm seeing all these fucking rocks that are round. Why the fuck are we not round?
Got it.
Is everything around us round, but not
got
us?
Got it. And by the way, round probably isn't the right term. You want to say ball or sphere or globe.
I'm just saying.
Okay, no, I'm just saying that.
Explain it to a 10-year-old.
No, that's fine. When you take that same telescope to a planetarium, because we're really kind of talking about a giant version of the Truman Show here, and you take that telescope and you're looking at Jupiter, does Jupiter look like a sphere inside the planetarium? Well, yes, it does. But then you say, well, yeah, but you're in a planetarium. My argument is when you walk outside of that planetarium, how do you know you're not just in a much bigger one? Because that's what we're talking about here. We're not just talking about that it's flat. We're talking about that you're in basically a giant snow globe / planetarium / terrarium.
This is
a
biodome only.
There you go.
So you're saying that Mars and Venus and all the other planets are not really far away.
No,
they're basically what just within our atmosphere or outside our atmosphere.
They're part of the projection system. They're part of the ceiling. More or less. Again, they are what you see up on the planetarium. When you go to a planetarium, they can simulate anything you want. You want to see a waxing, waning,
crescent.
Well,
that's a planetarium.
Hey, Mark.
That's
Mark,
the point.
Mark, do you get this a lot? Yes. You're a pothead, aren't you?
No, actually. I had a girlfriend that was really into it, but
I like weed. And I can't come up with this shit.
Well, wait.
I'm sure you get your ass busted.
This actually reminds me a little bit of a conversation I had with people while we were on weed.
But right, exactly.
If all of this is true, though, Mark,
and
it's all a big cover up, what's the end game? Why cover it up? Why tell people that we live on a globe, on a sphere, and just not let it be known? I mean, if science shows you that you live on a flat planet, and it's a dome, and all the planets are just within arm's reach in the atmosphere, and it's all just a projection. If that's what science really proves empirically, then why not just say that? What's the difference?
Because they went too long with the model they were already showing. So let me give you two quick examples. And the three of you, you've all watched the Truman Show movie before.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Truman, when he got to the outer edge, when he finally, you know, crashed his sailboat into whatever barrier it was.
Right.
You know, was the first thing he did. First thing it was, he waved, you know, he figured out, you know, who God was. He waved at him and left. All right. But that was because Truman had nothing left to lose. He realized his life was an entire lie. What if it wasn't Truman that made it out there in the sailboat? I'm using a brand new analogy. I've never used
I'm
this
with you.
Here before. What if the mayor of that town was the one in the sailboat and he got out there? What happens? Or a scientist that worked in the town, you know, what if he, we're assuming that more than just Truman was being fooled. The mayor didn't know. He gets out there. Well, he's got a lot more to lose when it comes to this. So let's say science figures it out in 1956. You know, let's say they go and they travel beyond the Antarctic coastline thousands of miles using their best explorer, Admiral Richard Byrd, in 1956 during Operation Deep Freeze. And let's say they find the outer marker and they just freak out. And they, you know, they have one of those, what do they call it, the authority meetings, the powers that be meetings, where, you know, the dark, sinister, smoking man, you know, room of people. It's like, okay, what's the worst that could happen to your question? What's the worst that could happen if we tell people? It's like, okay, let's see. First off, academic-wise, astronomy and astrophysics, that those entire things have to be burned down to the ground and rebuilt.
Right, get rid of Newton and Leibniz and calculus, because calculus is bullshit.
I'm not saying the calculus is BS. But every other physical science, biology, hydrology, archaeology, take your pick, all those have to be retooled severely.
But we've done that before with, like, you know, alchemy. People kind of abandoned that when they realized that's not,
yeah,
you know, not going anywhere.
But this is a little different. Okay, and let me get to the bigger stuff. Economically, we have a lot of industries that are, especially in every country, especially the major industrialized ones, that are based on...
I mean, the globe industry will go right out of business.
Well, not that. But weapons industries. I mean, look at America's chief export right now is defense systems. We sell missiles and planes and ships and tanks to all sorts of countries. Do you still go to war if we're part of the same family? Do you still have these massive conflicts if we are all in the same building, in the same snow globe, whatever
we
you
are.
Want to call it?
Sure, we are.
We
Absolutely.
Are.
Do you still? Well, okay.
The Earth is the same building.
Well,
the entire planet,
it leads to the third part of this, which is, and I don't want to, I'm not going to Bible thump here, you know, I'm not going to quote chapter and verse, but it leads into a spiritual side of it, which is, got to remember, the Earth doesn't prove a higher power. Earth doesn't prove intelligent design. However, an enclosed system, an enclosed world, oh, that leans a lot more towards that side of the field. And then you've got science that has a lot more to answer for. So science all of a sudden has to go, okay, we've been preaching this thing. We've been preaching the globe model for the last 400, back then it would be about 450 years. So what happens to science if we do this? What happens to our credibility? The foundations get shaken badly. And if there's any, even a risk of, you know, people, you know, pitchforks and torches walking through the streets, they're not going to take that chance. But the powers
that... I want to get high with this guy.
I swear to you, I've never
some dope with this
dude.
Cat.
Hey, Mark, don't take none of this personally.
Oh, no, it's okay.
Listen, you got to, and I'm sure you're used to it, because you're going around... whether we're right or wrong about the Earth being round, you have to understand that, like you said, that we've been preaching this for 400 years. So you've obviously fallen under some criticism.
Oh, yeah.
Some people have certainly called you fucking lunatic and shit like that.
Yeah.
And you don't sound crazy, although sound crazy.
Go ahead.
Nobody in this community is freaking monstrous now, since this thing started resurging back in the beginning of 2015. Nobody that gets into this, and myself included, nobody gets into this thinking it's the greatest idea since sliced bread. Everybody hates it. The t-shirt, one of the t-shirts that reads, I became a flat earther because I tried to debunk flat earth. I tried to shut this thing down for 9 months, and I was a conspiracy guy. And then finally, I just gave up, and I said, you know what? I'm going to flip. I'm going to go pro flat earth. I'm going to make a series of videos called Flat Earth Clues. I'm going to put it on YouTube. I'm going to say, you know what? challenge somebody shoot this thing down. Somebody prove me wrong. And I thought for sure this thing would have been snuffed out in the first month I put it out. And since then, not only has the opposite happened, and I've, you know, interviews and book and podcasts and apps and all this other crap that I didn't solicit, but then I had started getting subject matter experts that started coming out for on our side, which were, you know, the military thing we talked about briefly. It's like sniper instructor, artillery guy, tank guy, missile commander, submarine electronics guy, all saying the same thing. It's like, yeah, you know what? We don't use the Coriolis effect in just about any firing solution we use. We can't detect any spinning with any of our equipment. It's all just something we took for granted, along with the curvature. And it just kept being air traffic controllers, all sorts of different sorts of pilots. Everyone kept coming out and nobody was refuting them. And so finally, after a while, you know, we started, you know, the community just started growing and growing to where now, you know, you type in things, you go to a search engine, type is the Earth, see what comes up, or is the. And,
yeah, but that the popularity of any idea, yeah, does not convince me at all.
Oh,
the
no,
Kardashians,
no.
And to be fair,
if you're science-based, I do not expect to convince you during this. I fully don't. The absorption period really varies from people. Some people take several days. Some people take several weeks. And if you have a master's degree in any sort of physical science, there's nothing I can do anyway, because your mind's never going to let go of it. Until, like my sister, she says, you know, until I hear it on Fox News, I'm not going to believe it. But it's incredible. The let's put it this way: if you want it resonating, when you typed in flat Earth into YouTube, beginning of 2015, you might have gotten 50,000 hits. If you type it in now and sort by upload date to get the latest numbers, it's coming in, I think this morning, like 16.9 million. And yeah.
Well, we live on a crazy planet. I mean, look who our president is.
There's a conference, an actual flat Earth conference coming up in the fall in Raleigh, North Carolina.
There's also Comic Cons and Trekkie conventions and all kinds of fucking shit for. I mean, just because we got
a lot of crazy,
and I'm not trying to ride your ass hard about
But
dude, I mean, just because we have conventions and fucking people get together and shit.
But
I mean, I've seen people.
Well, that doesn't make Star Trek true.
I've seen people
whatever. Yeah.
I've seen people in Wookiee costumes make out. That doesn't make that real either.
But this shouldn't even be. There shouldn't be a conference on this. Why is Neil deGrasse Tyson
on My Little Pony bronies
yeah,
either.
But I've had people tell me that the planes that hit the World Trade Centers, there were no planes. That was all a Hollywood production, and it didn't really happen. So, I mean, you could find people that believe all kinds of shit. In fact, these days, it's almost like cool to be a conspiracy theorist and believe that, oh, it's all the government's just pulling one over on us, and, you know, that's the train you want to get on these days.
Sure.
So that doesn't surprise me that there's more people following this idea. It really doesn't.
What about the mainstream attention that's happened over the last?
Well, if you get more people on board and they keep making noise in social media and going on talk shows, even like this one, as small as we are, but still, spread that around, multiply it by 100, and yeah, of course it's going to start to attract attention of mainstream because. Yeah,
but it's still crazy, right? I mean, I agree with you to some point, but at the same time, no one in the academic world has even come close to trying to shoot this thing down yet. In fact, the closest we got was Neil deGrasse Tyson coming on Comedy Central because of the whole BOB thing that happened in 2016, where you know, B.O.B. came out and said, oh, yeah, it's flat. And then Neil deGrasse Tyson comes on Comedy Central and says, oh, yeah, well, you can't see the curvature of the Earth, which we really should talk about, by the way.
We're getting there.
Until you get, you know, no civilian can get high enough to see the curvature of the Earth. And I'm going, okay, well, that's fine, except you're leaving then the responsibility and the proof in the hands of the United States military. Because NASA is DOD, Department of Defense. I mean, yeah,
right.
they wear white suits, they don't carry guns, and they smile for the camera. but they are uniquely military, you know.
So there's millions of military personnel all across this world. And I'm not talking about just the United States military, but all kinds of military who are all in on the whole secret.
No, again, and I can't be more adamant about this, which is almost, this thing is so big that nobody knows about it. This is a secret so big that when Antarctica was discovered to be pretty much made out of money and full of natural resources, they locked it down and put in the 1959 Antarctic Treaty, which also, by the way, was the same year the Van Allen Belt was announced, and said that no corporation from any country can ever set up shop there ever. And every country that becomes a power unilaterally signs this. China, Russia, UK, Australia, it doesn't make a difference. And you're saying, well, that doesn't necessarily prove anything. Well, it doesn't. But at the same time, if I'm an oil company, say I work for British Petroleum, and not only am I not allowed to go down there, even though there's oil down there, but I'm not even allowed to talk about it. I should be running a full page ad in the London Times every week saying how great it would be for my company to be down there. You're not even allowed to talk about going down there. And that was right after, you know, the Admiral Byrd Operation Deep Freeze, where whatever they found, and for me, there was no doubt, they found the outer marker. They found the outer boundary of this place. They said, nope, we're going to lock it down. Even though the mountain range is made out of coal, uranium, oil, minerals, it's forever locked down in the name of science now. But 1959, Greenpeace wasn't even found until the 1970s.
So basically the two options in a flat earth theory are, either this is the hugest, craziest conspiracy theory ever, and it has to be true because it's that fucking insane, or it's just not true.
Yeah, one of those two. But again, to be clear, it's so big that you don't want to really tell anybody about it. You don't even want people to find out about it on accident.
Why?
If you can help it, because we went over that a little bit. Yeah, it rocks too many things. I mean, science would have to look. I don't want to necessarily pick on the religious right, but you know full well what the religion. And I don't know what you guys.
We're pretty much atheists.
Yeah. Oh, okay, good. That'll work in this case. Do you know what the religious right would do if they found out there may be proof of intelligent design? There would be some sort of handprint of God out there. Science would be on the ropes for years because they'd
so
be
what
like,
you're saying is this is a handprint of God.
Not saying that, but at the same time, because there's only one of two options. It's either this place was built by some sort of divine influence, or God subcontracted out the work. You know, it's either advanced civilization, obviously, someone way better at building things than we are. But either way, you know, if we met whoever built this place,
you're causing me to drink.
Yeah, you're causing John to start getting the alcohol.
He's got
already.
Two kinds of whiskey in front.
I'm sorry.
Like to point out.
But the first question we would ask the builders is, okay, are you God? And they'd say, well, no. And then the next question would be like, well, do you know God's phone number? Because you're obviously closer to this than we are.
Who the fuck built it, E.T.?
I don't know.
Why do we limit ourselves to those two options? Why are we saying that either it has to be made by a god or he subcontracted it out?
Well,
it can't come about natural means. That can't happen.
Would natural means? I mean, in enclosed flat structure.
That's accurate. But yeah, I mean, any other way.
I mean, if that, well, that's just it. That's the point. A globe, you know, a tiny speck of rock spinning through an endless, you know, galaxy, you know, within.
It's too easy explained.
Occam's razor.
That's far too easily explained. It has to be deeper than that. It has to be flat with a globe built by aliens, contracted by God. Dude, come on. I mean, seriously.
I'm not trying to
fuck with you. I can't help myself.
No. No, it's good. I like.
You're talking about a fucking cartoon movie. I swear to God. I'm not trying to be mean, but it sounds so.
At the same,
it's so fucking far out there that I'm.
I know.
I'm gonna lose my shit. I can't. I know, man. And you seem like a reasonably intelligent dude. And I kind of fucking dig you, right? You're smart. dude, I could talk to you hours about the whole video
I'm
game.
Smart.
I got a line for you. You'll like this, and I don't want to blow your mind too badly, man. Trust me on this.
You can't possibly fucking go out further than you already have.
Oh, I can. Actually, I can.
Here we go. Let's hear it.
Ready? Okay, so here's a little thought experiment for you. We all know, because eventually, and I'll use a quote from George Orwell, where he wrote in the Tribune, the guy that wrote 1984. He did an article for the Tribune back in 1946, and he goes, and he's not a flat earther, but he said something interesting. He was talking about the responsibility.
Well, then he's smart.
Yeah. He said the responsibility of science. He says, hey, he goes, you ask anybody on the street, you know, how they know the earth is a globe, right? And they will say, well, the first answer is always the same, which is, we know it's a globe. Why would you even ask such a question? It's dumb. But if you pressed them on it, they would start to become angry. My follow-up question is this. The very first picture of the Earth taken from space in full sunlight, if you believe it, was taken in 1972. So, that, again, that was the first time we actually took a full picture of the Earth from
Earthrise.
Well, it wasn't even Earthrise. It was,
wasn't it called Earthrise? It was taken from the moon, correct?
No. This one was that wasn't even full disc in sunlight. That was
full disc.
The actual full circle Earth, the Earth, taken in 1972. You all know what it is. It shows the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica.
Oh yeah,
from Apollo 17. So the question is, before that picture was taken, how did you know it was a globe? And then you go back, well, no, NASA took pictures all the way. Okay, fine. If you want to go back to 1958, we will, when NASA was founded, which was only 12 years earlier, by the way. 1958, NASA was founded. How did you know before NASA was founded that the Earth was a globe?
Hold on.
Eratosthenes.
Yeah, I know. Sticks and shadows argument, curved circles on
so that's bullshit?
No. Not saying it's BS. I'm trying not to swear, even
because,
though you guys...
you can swear all you want. We do. But no, if I'm here and I have somebody go to Florida and we talk on a cell phone and say, okay, what's your measurement at noon? And I take my measurement at noon and we look, they will be different.
Sure.
There's no doubt about that.
I agree. I agree with you on that. But
shadow.
Again, sticks and
shadows. I'm fully aware, but how can you agree? And then, go ahead.
Because sticks and shadows argument is, for lack of a better term, relative. Meaning, yeah, it works if the sun is 93 million miles away and hundreds of thousands of miles across, but it also works if the sun is much
closer.
Is
it real?
Is the sun real?
Yeah.
It's a real object, but it's...
Why does it rise in the east and set in the west if you're in America? How the fuck does that happen?
Well, how are we in different time zones? Because aren't you in the west coast?
Okay, one question at a time. Okay.
All right, now, I don't know. It just...
Rises in the east, sets in the west.
We'll do the time zone thing because these are good questions. And I've heard them all. The how can there be time zones because you're thinking using your the heliocentric model and you're trying to apply it to flat Earth. You're saying that the sun is this giant omnidirectional light source.
What are you saying it is?
I'm saying it's a directional light source. It's much, much smaller, and because it is so much smaller, and it circles above us, kind of like a mobile above a child's crib. Kind of like if you took the yin yang symbol, if you look at that thing closely, and then you kind of stick it on top of the UN flag or the UN map. That's how it works. The sun and the moon travel in a circle around us, and as it goes away, it just goes off into the distance. And eventually, you will not be able to see it because it's not a super, super bright omnidirectional light source. It is more of a spotlight. And it works really well. I've got a physical model in my place.
I don't know if I like this guy or I hate him. I don't know.
No.
Let me
go back to the first part here real quick.
If you had any idea who the fuck I was and my shit and the shit that I've done in my life, for me to worry about you, that's pretty fucking concerning, dude. You should be scared. Holy shit.
I know. Okay, so anyway, the point is that when it comes to, again, before NASA, and again, how did you know absolutely for sure that the Earth was a globe? And you say, well, it's this experiment and this experiment. Yeah, but until you get high enough, and I know Neil deGrasse Tyson will completely argue this. He goes, pictures don't matter. It's like, no. Until you get high enough to take the picture of where you are. How do you know where you are exactly? You could be 99.99% sure, but until you get up high enough to actually take the shot, how do you know? How do you really know?
This may not be the podcast for you, just saying, because you are on the radio with a guy with a master's degree in mathematics, and a scientist, and a well-educated redneck. And I'll let you figure out which one's which, but we are and of the three, a well-educated redneck is by far the most baffled. And maybe it's because I've been duped. Okay, I'll go with that. Because of years and years of programming me to believe that the Earth is round. In spite of, don't get me wrong, I'm not.
But if this,
just because I are redneck,
I'm
educated.
It's not just that, though. It's that, like, I mean, for instance, in science, you have multiple things that, that fit with the theory of evolution, for instance. And with this, it's like you have. I don't want to say the assumption that this is true, but other things, like, for instance, when you take a plane ride, they adjust the course of the plane to account for the curvature of the Earth. Or, you know, I mean, NASA, when they went to the moon, they made calculations based on, you know, how fast the Earth was spinning and et cetera. And it worked pretty much. They landed, I think it was 6 feet or something off on the moon from where they had originally thought they were. But the point is it's like people take these things into account and it works. So
science works.
Okay. Okay. No, I got you.
Works.
So
it's based
just
upon
a round Earth or a spherical Earth.
Right. But go ahead.
No, that's okay. I probably haven't prefaced this show very well, because there's going to be some flat earthers eventually listening to some sort of rebroadcast of this, forgive me. Do you guys believe in any conspiracies at all, or are we
very open minded to many of them and consider many of them and the possibilities of many of them.
Okay.
But all of us have different views on each of them. But we're not anti-conspiracy theory, not by any means.
But all of you believe that the moon mission was absolutely like the Americans said. It is 100% genuine.
I would go on the 95%.
I would go on the 99% that it is. I mean, there's certain things that you can see and do that can prove it to you. But
got it. This is going to be a tough sell then for me. Because the moon mission is, I mean, NASA, we've been tearing apart NASA for the last couple of years now, and it's the moon mission is one of the easiest things you can do. But I don't want to stick on the moon mission. I mean, let's do this.
Except even if the moon mission were fake, that doesn't help us.
It
on
doesn't.
The
it
does,
no. It's not. It's
that
not going to
prove anything.
Right, I feel like that's
no.
a separate issue here.
I brought it up in the beginning before you even got here.
Right.
Kind of because I wanted to see where he stood on conspiracy theories, and that was like the main one, basically because it is kind of
It is kind of
important to the flat Earth theory.
The moon mission thing. Let me at least spend a 60 seconds on the moon mission thing, which is the moon mission kind of bugged me because as a conspiracy guy, I couldn't figure out, because I always like looking for the reasons, the big question, why. It's like, okay, why are you, because a lot of people say, why would you fake the moon mission? I'm just going, yeah, I mean, being an American, you get it. It's like, oh, wave the flag, rah, rah, go team. You know, we're the greatest. I get that. You know, it's like, okay, but it's not, it's a good reason, but it's not a great reason. And then when I got into this, that's when everything kind of clicked. When it came to NASA, it's like, oh, I get it. I get
right.
it now. It's a, you don't want to fake the moon mission. You have.
I needed
to,
that one.
You have to fake it, because if you don't, eventually, sooner or later, one of the subcontractors is going to get involved and the corporations, and you do not want the private sector anywhere near this for as long as you can, which is, and you say, well, Virgin Galactic and SpaceX, but they're very, very recent compared to the guys that could have gotten into a long time ago, like Lockheed Martin or General Dynamics or Boeing. You do not want them doing anything on their own. You have to militarize space. And that's exactly what they did. And, you know, in 1958, NASA was founded. And when they did that, It was a brilliant move. The big move was
partially because the original rockets were based off of military missiles that were already in existence, so it made sense.
Yeah, it did.
Okay. Now that we have. Let's go with Virgin, because Virgin is
SpaceX is probably a better one.
Just go with any one of them. Just pick one. Okay. How can the government and NASA and all the powers that be and whoever is ultimately in charge of this, keeping the flat Earth theory quiet, thing, whoever is in charge of that, how can they possibly let that goofy old guy from Virgin Atlantic come up with this, he's going to fly to the moon shit?
Quick correction. Right? Branson from Virgin Galactic, he's not going anywhere. You're thinking of Elon Musk from SpaceX. Yeah, when he announced that he's going to be – I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry. But it was – I mean, Virgin is Richard Branson.
He's the old guy you're talking about.
Right. And he's one of the original guys who was going to privatize the
whole thing.
About
SpaceX, who stands a much better chance of getting there.
But I'm just saying go back to when Virgin first started. How can the fucking powers that be who want to hold on to this flat Earth theory and keep it a secret allow him to do such a thing? If this super guy or group or board or whatever who's keeping this secret is so strong and so powerful that they're able to shut people down from going to the fucking Antarctic, why can't they stop this cocksucker from building a fucking rocket?
Well, that's just it. They stopped him for the most part. He hasn't sent anybody anywhere.
They delayed testing.
Not yet, but they're working on it.
They've been kicking that can down the road. Virgin Galactic, I don't even know how.
For like 15 whole fucking years.
Rocketry is not easy.
Right.
It's not an easy thing.
It is.
Okay. And to your point, if rocketry isn't easy, then how in the world is SpaceX even making the claim that they're going to be taking tourists around the moon? What, a year from now, around the moon in a
fucking Tesla.
Please. In a booster that's never been tested, in a capsule that's never been tested. We don't even know who the pilots are. We don't know who the passengers are. And they say they're going to go around the moon.
A lot of things look impossible until you establish the goal and actually go after
people
it.
People said we couldn't walk on the moon.
When they try this next year, they're going to be breaking just about every unwritten rule that NASA has ever kept in over the last 60 years. One is, I don't know. Let's take the fact that never in the history of space travel to date has any exterior shot from any astronaut, I don't care if it's Mercury, Gemini, Apollo, Soyuz, has ever taken a 180 degrees or better panning shot. No one's ever turned around with the camera running, ever in the history of that. They're going to break that rule supposedly right off the bat. No camera ever from the launch pad all the way up to wherever they're going has ever left the Earth and come back with the camera running ever.
What about mushrooms? You've done mushrooms?
No, I actually thought about it when I was in college, but because I saw some guys that were laughing in the hallway.
It's pretty good shit.
Well, I've heard some good and bad things, but the ones that make you laugh a lot, I've heard, I like those. Never done this. I'm about as normal. Well, I'm relatively normal. I'm pretty eccentric.
Don't know about that. That's a big negatory
If this thing, if I would have been shot down in the first couple of months, I would have quit this thing right immediately. I would have said, some professor.
So you're riding this out just to see how far you can take it.
To be fair, though, you're saying that nobody can nobody's come close to refuting this. But the thing is, if you kind of referring to everybody in your movement, not just dismiss out of hand like all the pieces of evidence, like, well, the pictures are fake and this is fake, and then I mean, that's like, there's only so much that you can do. It's like, I can't help
that's just it. Show just me like... that, because you're gonna say, well, what can eventually, you guys are gonna get to the question, it's like, what will shut this whole community down? What can we do as a science group that'll shut the community down? It's like,
just so that you're clear, before you go too far, the three of us sitting at this table, we honestly don't give a shit. You are talking to three people who could give a fuck what you believe. And we are so laid back and easygoing.
The weight room is calling me. I can give a damn.
Yeah. And dude, as much as I'm riding your ass and busting your balls, it's, dude, we can go snort moonshine and drink cocaine all night with hookers. I don't give a shit. We can hang out. We can have fun. It's all cool. You believe what you believe. We're not out here to shut you down. We're actually here to give you a voice. And this was a huge thing. When Mike brought this up, I'm like, I can't wait to get this guy on. I want to hear this because I've looked into this, and to me, the whole thing sounds like shit. I mean, all the way across the board. So I wanted to hear somebody because I Googled you, and I saw your pretty little face in your Green Lantern shirt on one of them. So I saw you, and I'm like, well, maybe this guy's pretty smart. You know, I mean, I want to hear what he has to say. But the more you talk, the more – I mean, even I'm kind of and listen, I'm by far the least educated of the three sitting at the table.
Yeah,
but I'm kind of like, dude, you sound fucking insane.
Like
a good kind of insane. Like again, let's go snort some moonshine. But come on.
In fact, I thought I was insane when I built the first video. In fact, that was the
and
first
you are
line.
Right.
Thank you for being objective. The first line from the video was, "It's insane. It's ludicrous." In fact, if you don't laugh at this thing the first time you hear it or get angry, then there's probably something wrong with you because it's the conditioning. It was so easy to do. You just put a globe in the classroom when you're 6 years old. You leave it there quietly in the corner until whenever you decide to quit school, and that's it. It's easy. That's all anybody knows. It's like, this is where you live, period.
Okay, but let's be honest. The globe in the classroom and its little subconscious message from off in the corner really has very little to do with why the three people sitting on at this table on these microphones talking to you believe that the Earth is round.
Are you sure about that?
Oh, yeah.
Because other than the globe in your classroom, what NASA footage would you produce? Because eventually everybody's going to lean on a space program. And if it's not NASA, fine. It's going to be the other space program.
Well, here's the thing. I could produce NASA footage till I'm blue in the face, but you're on the side of NASA's full of shit because they're fucking hiding the conspiracy. So it doesn't matter. That's like you reciting the Bible to one of us atheists. What good is the fucking Bible? You're reciting a Bible to atheists. Well, sure. The Bible says you shall believe in God. Well, fucking, where's the fucking scientific proof in that? So you say for me telling you that NASA says the globe is round is the same thing as a Christian saying, well, the Bible says Jesus is fucking real. So I wouldn't produce anything from NASA for you. You know what I mean? It's just
No, I got you. It's just that when everybody, again, the community grows because they keep trying to lean, they start with the same argument you do, and it's like, you know what, I'm going to go home and I'm going to do this to myself, you know, figure out what this is just so I can sleep well tonight, and I can smugly say, well, I'm not calling you guys smug, smugly say, you know what, those people were a bunch of crap, and here I'm, you know, the world is exactly what I think it is. It's the Tommy Lee Jones line from Men in Black, and that is, people like they think they have a good bead on things. And that's how everyone starts when they look at this. It's like, we know it's a globe. How do you know it's a globe?
You think we've been visited by aliens?
How did you know? Wait. How did you know it was a globe? I know you guys probably aren't old enough. How did you guys know in the 1960s that it was a globe? Eventually, you're going to have to go back. Eventually, you're going to have to say the same thing that everybody does. Well, science told us. It's not something
a couple of us were born right around then.
Really?
Okay.
Very late.
Yeah, our lovely Alex was a late bloomer, but Mike and I are fucking old as shit.
Her picture looks. I'm looking at her graphics. She looks pretty young.
You should see her real picture.
John should speak for himself when he calls us old as shit.
Yeah. Well, I'm old as shit. I'm actually like a year or two younger than Mike.
Let me throw one out at you because you guys I know have been on the offensive, but we got to bring up the curvature thing eventually.
All right, come on.
Yeah,
the Flat Earth community has been absorbing a lot of mainstream science stuff just to help our points. And one of them, one of the first ones we did was the curvature of the Earth, 8 inches per mile squared. Which means, for those people who don't know math very well, and I had to look it up too, to be honest, which is 8 inches times every mile times itself. So if it's 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4 times 8 is 32 inches. 3 times 3 is 9 times 8 is 72 inches. And it just gets worse from there. To when you get up around, I don't know, 50 miles, that's 50 times 50 times 8 inches, which is about almost 1,700 feet of curvature, you know, 1,700 feet on the other side of the hill. And because eventually, I'm really surprised you guys haven't brought this up. You guys must be pretty intelligent, because a lot of people will say, well, you see boats go over the horizon, and they go hull first, and then they disappear off into the distance. And or they'll say, well, you fall off the edge. But the boats going off in the horizon is very, very interesting, because what's really changed in the last 10 years has been camera technology, especially like the Nikon Coolpix P900 with that insane like 80 power zoom or whatever it is. Right. So the boat goes off into the horizon, without looking through a telescope or anything, or maybe you're using binoculars, goes off in the horizon, and you think it's gone over the horizon, right? It's on the other side of the hill. No matter what you do, you should not be able to bring that boat back into frame. And yet, we keep doing it time and time again. You keep cranking up the zoom. Oh, hey, there's the boat.
A lot of that is like emissions from the water from the heat. There's like, you ever like drive down a road and it looks like there's water on the road that's kind of like heat coming off the road.
It's a mirage. So
that's kind of like part of that. Yeah. To some extent.
In all weather conditions, we can't find an object less than, depending on where you are, because we always have to look over a body of water, because if we say it's over a body of land, people will say, well, it's just a flat part on a curved surface. It's like, okay, fine. Well, so we'll talk about water only. Find me an object that is, say, 150 miles away over a body of water. I don't care if it's stationary, if it's a lighthouse, if it's a building, if it's a boat, or whatever it is, that we can't see. Meaning 150 miles, that's way on the other side of the hill. Way, way, way on the other side of the hill when it comes to the curvature. Of the curvature.
Right.
And yet we keep seeing it. Now, eventually...
On a flat Earth, I should be able to see the Rocky Mountains from here.
Perfect. And I thank you for bringing that up. If it was a vacuum and there was no weather at all, you would be able to see very, very far. Some people said, what was it? You can see, why can't we see, what's the point? Like somewhere in Italy from New York or something like that. Why can't you see Europe from New York? I'm going, if it was a vacuum and there was no weather at all, you probably could see very, very far. The problem is that we're not looking through.
Want to get high with this guy.
The stuff that we breathe, speaking of breathing, is only 20% oxygen. The rest is nitrogen. It's 80-20 nitrogen and oxygen. I know there's trace gases, but it doesn't make any difference.
Right.
Which is, so after a certain distance, it's going to turn into soup. It's like looking, the stuff we breathe is really like a thin version of water. So you can't see very far anyway. I mean, relatively far. But less than 200 miles, there should be objects that are gone. They are on the other side of the curvature. And yet we keep seeing them, whether they be islands, whether they be lighthouses, whatever. Mirages, no. A superior mirage is inverted. We keep seeing these things. Why is it? Why can we see these objects? And we can see them. There will be some atmospheric lensing from time to time, sure. But that's easy to spot. You can actually, the easiest way to spot atmospheric lensing is look for the birds, because the birds will just fly down and they'll disappear without hitting the water. Yeah, I know. So anyway, that was the curvature thing. The curvature wasn't even part of my original argument when I made the video series. It was just people kept bringing it up because I thought there might be a slight curve somewhere in this whole thing. And people go, no, no, it's really, really flat. And I was going, really? Is it flat? Now I'm convinced.
You said earlier that you felt that we were on the offensive, other than me busting your balls a little bit.
No, I don't mind.
You don't really think we're on the offensive, are you?
Well, no.
We are trying to get to the bottom of this.
Given your background,
really trying to give you.
I'm
a
on
forum.
The offensive.
Fuck. Well, he is.
Fuck
yeah.
Hazel. Fuck him. But listen, we are just trying to give you a voice and a platform because.
No, I got.
I'll be real honest. I wanted to hear this. I really wanted to hear this, but. And maybe I'm just too fucking stubborn, but the more I hear, the more I'm like, dude.
Oops, I'm sorry.
Well, thank you.
No.
Yeah, that was our commercial. We want to thank McAllen Scotch Whiskey for
we stick with 2 second commercials.
Yeah, right. So anyway, the more you talk, the more I'm like, dude, you're killing me.
Anyone with, by the way, with a heavy math background is going to, you know, you're going to be spending, your peers are going to be, you're going to have a lot of scientific peers.
It has nothing to do with peers or scientific peers. It's got to do with mathematics. Mathematics works. And it works if you consider a sphere. If you consider the Earth as a sphere, I'm sorry, but the math works. I mean, you can provide a proof logically, empirically, that shit works. I mean, any other method, if you want to say that it's flat, then all of mathematics is bullshit, and it all breaks down.
No.
We can talk. You want to talk calculus and how much of that is just complete shit? Because gravity can't. I'm sorry. How does gravity fit into everything if we're on a flat Earth?
How does gravity work on a sphere? Neil deGrasse Tyson comes out. He goes. Look, mainstream science will tell you we can't tell you what gravity is. We can only tell you what it does.
Yes, you can tell what it does, but where is it most likely happening? Because we're in a non-inertial frame because of the curvature of Earth. The gravity that you feel, essentially, like when you're in a car and you feel yourself accelerating, and let's say you're going 10 miles per second, per second. So you're accelerating and you continue to accelerate. Once you reach, let's say, 60 miles per hour, you no longer feel that force pushing you back in the seat because you are now going the exact same speed as the car.
Sure.
But if you continued accelerating, you would continue to feel that.
Yep.
Well, on Earth, you're in what's called a non-inertial frame. Due to the curvature of space-time, you are feeling the acceleration constantly.
Boom! Gravity, bitches.
In a heliocentric model, that's work. That might work. But it also works on a flat enclosed system.
How?
What is gravity if we are just a snow globe on somebody's desk? It's just a force that pulls straight down.
What's the desk sitting on?
Well, that's just it. I try to live one world at a time if I can. But
then we're the only ones that are flat because Jupiter's round, Mars is round,
go to the Hayden Planetarium. Mars looks great. The Hayden Planetarium. It doesn't mean that it's a sphere. It just means that
observe it through a telescope as well.
Again, if you take binoculars,
all by myself.
I don't need the planetarium.
I don't have to go to a planetarium.
Okay, Truman Show reference. You look up in the sky. If this place is a giant building, then you can look with any magnification.
Who's operating the projector?
Good point.
Well, question. Who's operating the projector?
I believe, you're going to ask eventually, I believe that there are older civilizations than us, that we are not the first people to rent this apartment by any stretch. We could be version 7. And even you guys would have to admit, look, our unbroken history only goes back 5,000 years. There's a lot of stuff out there that's really, really old.
There are cave paintings that go back over 30,000 years.
Okay, what about the
unless you're going to claim that dating is all bullshit, too. Radiometric dating is not bullshit.
Carbon dating? Yeah.
No, not just carbon. Radiometric. I know how people love to go to carbon-14 and claim, well, it doesn't work beyond, 5,000. It only has a half-life of 5,700-some-odd years. Yeah. I don't know why I'm getting that hiss, but anyway, it only has a half-life of that, so that's no good. But that's only one method, and it's not used to date things a million years.
No.
Fine,
but either way, and it doesn't. Okay, listen. The three of us have had discussions and stuff. Listen, with we believe that the Earth is round and the universe is huge and the same as some snow globe.
Sure.
All right. So we have no doubt that the possibilities of life elsewhere and other civilizations elsewhere. There's definitely a possibility. Even a probability, as far as I'm concerned, my personal opinion is there's a probability. I'm not saying that Area 51 or whatever that we've been visited by aliens. I don't know about all that, but I'm certain that it is so naive to think that if all that we're taught and all that the three of us sitting at this table believe is true, that we're the only solar system, and we know we're not the only solar system by everything that we're taught. So there's
no,
not
we
another.
Actually, the Hubble has seen solar systems in various forms of development.
So there's not other planets equidistant from the sun as the Earth with a similar atmosphere and maybe even slightly different with a different type of life form, but life forms nonetheless. So, I got one possibilities. We are
I got one for you, John. Do you know what the greatest UFO sighting of all time is?
None. E.T., I watched the fucking movie.
What is the greatest one of all
time? Look it up if you get a chance. 1561 Nuremberg event.
I've heard of that.
It's in Wikipedia. It is the most, that'll blow your mind, and nobody talks about it. I mean, yeah, ancient aliens brought it up once, but they still left out the best part.
Is this the one where people thought that they saw spaceships battling in the sky, or am I thinking of a different one?
They saw spaceships, two armadas battling for an entire hour to where they, finished breakfast.
Star Trek 3 and shit, I swear to God.
But not just the two armadas. No, that was just the first part of it. After a full hour, a third faction chump comes in, which was a single black angular craft, giant, pulls it between the two of them. Those two scatter. Then the black craft stays there for a big little while, and then they take off. That thing that just screams hierarchy. They did a woodcut. I mean, of the whole thing, it was in their paper. The sketch artist had plenty of time to sketch out the entire thing in great detail.
The sketch artist sketched it out.
I just did a quick
given Google that.
It's a beautiful
you're
woodcut.
You're going off a certain small area, a region that came up with this, the Nuremberg, and all of this. Okay, so that's probably more realistic than the fact that the Earth is round. That's not a conspiracy, but the Earth being round is a conspiracy, is what you're telling me. So you're picking and kind of choosing.
No. I'm just saying, if you're going down the alien.
Hold on. Yeah, for that matter, I read in the Bible that there was a fucking worldwide flood and 40 days and 40 nights of rain, and on one ark, there was enough people to inhabit the entire planet and drop off kangaroos and fucking Australia and fucking. Penguins and fucking
That and of course you're missing the biggest point of that, which is where did all the different races of people come from?
Well, that too, but I'm just saying. You're using a regional explanation of an event that happened in the sky between two fucking UFOs, and I see a correlation between it and a regional event about a fucking arc and some rain.
Well, I'm not saying it didn't happen, but it's hearsay. We don't have.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Right. A bunch of people said.
I won't even say that
they saw this. An entire city.
They may have, or maybe they saw something and that's how they interpreted it, or they thought that they saw it. But we don't know. That's evidence.
You can
that
go
wouldn't
online
hold up in
you've
court,
got,
you know?
And look
you,
at this. You can go online.
You've got an entire fucking planet with some group of people who have corralled an entire fucking planet.
Yeah.
Into believing that the Earth is round when it's really not, but you can't have an entire fucking city believing that a goddamn UFO fight happened over their fucking city. Dude, it would be far easier for a government to control the people into believing some bullshit fucking UFO. And I'm not saying that the UFO fight didn't happen, okay?
Yeah.
But if we're talking about conspiracy theories, it'd be so much easier for one fucking city to fool their people into believing that a UFO fight happened over their city than it would be to fool an entire planet of people, or a flat globe, a snow globe of people, for hundreds and hundreds of fucking years to believe that the Earth is fucking round.
It's easier than you might think, though, man. Think about it.
To fool people with a fucking UFO.
The bigger it is, though, if the borders are far enough away, it is quite easy. Remember the line from the Truman Show, which is, "We believe the world that is presented to us." We accept the world as presented to us. Look at the line from, and again, it's more of an obscure movie. M. Night Shyamalan, M. Night Shyamalan, The Village.
These are movies.
No. That's my point. Isn't it possible with all the most wonderful, fantastic science fiction that we have come up with over the years, out of all the thousands and thousands and thousands of stories that we've come up with over the years, and some of them have touched on this, obviously.
I used to like Lost in Space when I was a kid, right? Yeah. All right, I watched that shit like a couple years ago just because I'm like, oh, dude, Lost in Space, like the original one, the original cast. And I look at that shit and I'm like, the fuck was, I thought that that was the coolest shit ever. And it's only like 30, 40 years old, man.
We come up with a lot of stories. But
no, I got you.
But
you're like, our technology.
We believe our elders. We believe the authority. The village.
That's not
Shyamalan.
True. That's not true. I don't believe authority. I believe
empiricism. You don't believe authority.
I believe in empiricism. Show me the evidence. I should be able to empirically test it myself. I don't believe in what someone tells me. It doesn't matter what someone says. It doesn't matter what his name is, what his title is. That has no bearing on fact whatsoever.
Yeah.
What matters is what can be shown through evidence.
Excellent. My point, actually, which is if science, you want to say scientists, sometimes I get in trouble. People say, well, you can't just say science, but I'm going to say science in this case. If science, after all those years of preaching the globe, finally got up to a certain point where they said, it doesn't look exactly like we said it was, would they tell the public?
Yes.
Would they?
I believe
so. Who said yes? You said yes?
But yeah, you know what? Do you know how much money somebody could make if they were able
to
actually prove that the Earth is flat? Do you realize how rich you would be?
If a Richard Branson type or an Elon Musk type were to fly to the fucking Antarctic and find the edge, like the Truman Show, the sailboat thing, the whole fucking scenario, if someone were able to do that,
video it,
prove that shit, do you know who that man's a fucking god.
That man's
that dude's
dead.
A god on this planet.
That man is killed instantly. There's no way he's going to ever get to talk about that.
It's very convenient to just say, well, hell, that person will just be dead. It's a big conspiracy. They'll never allow the truth out. Well, then,
I'm putting myself in their shoes.
You're going to kill Elon Musk, and that's not going to be like, what the fuck? We know Elon Musk because Elon Musk has the ability to transmit live fucking video. So we know that motherfucker was up to something, and then all of a sudden his feed cuts off and he dies. You don't think that that's going to raise public eye?
What do you think happened to Richard Byrd? And he was a United States admiral, youngest admiral in United States Navy history. What do you think happened to him? He was touring for years and years, talking about his explorations. The second he does Operation Deep Freeze, he comes back, dies quietly in his apartment. No fanfare whatsoever. It's because he wasn't going to be able to keep his mouth shut. They knew that. This is too big. There's too much to lose. Yes, there's a lot of money to be made. Sure, of course. But that's from an individual standpoint. The greater good always wins out here.
We're kind of running low on time, so why don't go? Let's. I don't know if we covered it or not because we've been kind of all over the road. But the whole curvature of the Earth.
And give me 2 seconds.
Sure, the eight inches per mile squared.
Hold on a second, Mark. I'm gonna give you 5 seconds right back to that.
Sure.
I googled Nuremberg 1561. Right.
Yep.
And the first three things I see are Nuremberg 1561 debunked. Now yeah. I haven't looked into them, and you know, fuck all that. It is the internet, so no. Not everything, in spite of commercials, not everything on the internet is true. But
look
why
at
the
wiki,
the first
look
three
at the,
things that popped up?
Look at the wiki entry on it.
I don't fuck a wiki entry. Goddamn wiki is more of a fucking consensus of what people think happened than facts that actually happened. So I'm not
gonna
change
wiki.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I can fucking fix that shit right now. So I'm not going on wiki, and I'm not saying fuck you, you're wrong, and I'm not saying fuck you, I'm right. I'm just saying you said Google it, right?
Yeah.
So I Googled it. The first three things that popped up are debunked. Now don't get me wrong, History Channel has their show Ancient Aliens, and that was number 3 on the list. So not so sure that the dude with the big hair and the fucking wild wacky dude
aliens,
is,
man.
Yeah, dude. Cuz I want to get high with that motherfucker.
I love that
too.
Guy.
I want to get high with him in the worst way.
You just want to get high with someone.
Hey, I don't know. Not just someone. I want to get high with somebody who has some fucking whacked out views because I want to enjoy my high. Hey, look, I have a license that does not allow me to get high. I get random tested way entirely too much. But the day that I retire, I'm getting stoned, and I want to get stoned with Mark fucking Sargent. This motherfucker is awesome. This dude slays me. Him and I are getting some strippers. And some weed, and we're going out. You don't have to smoke no weed, Mark.
You should go to the conference,
dude. Oh, I don't know if I could handle it. I might get arrested.
Oh, I couldn't,
dude. Hazel has a hard time taking me out in public as it is, so I'm pretty sure you can't put me in that crowd. I can handle one of you because you're pretty cool. You've taken an ass whooping kind of hard
I don't mind.
Yeah,
actually,
you're pretty
cool,
and I appreciate it. I honestly appreciate it. I really, truly do. And this is not a lot of what I do on the podcast is a little bit of John amplified, because I am kind of like this, but yes, usually amplified. But you have actually got me real. This is not fucking amplified. I am like, what the fuck, dude? You have got me in a whole different genre. So I appreciate you talking more about the curvature. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, it's okay. Was I supposed to, or was John supposed to? I'm sorry.
What's that? Me, Mike?
Yeah, you, Mike.
Yeah, I'm John. I'm the drunk redneck that and I mean I'm getting drunker as we go, dude.
Who's supposed to talk about the curvature? Is it me?
Well, you go right.
Oh, okay.
You.
Well, the curvature thing, when it comes to the curvature, what I already explained. Find me a scientist that will come forward and say, okay, because that should be the easiest one. One of the reasons this thing is resonating so easily is because, you know, a lot of people live on a coastline or near some body of water. So everybody goes out there with a camera and starts shooting stuff. And the YouTube's got all sorts of videos on it where it's like, oh yeah, here's a ship, here's a lighthouse, here's a building. The Chicago skyline, perfect example, 52 miles away, shouldn't be able to see any of it. Shouldn't be able to see a single building of that thing. It should be a couple thousand feet.
Not even right. Hold on, back up a second.
But why shouldn't you be able to? Do you have like math to back that up?
No. Your curvature of the math when you were talking about, 8 feet per mile and
eight inches per mile times itself.
Okay, yeah. So 50 miles out. Why? And I understand the whole by times it so.
50 okay. times 50 times 8, which is about 1,700 feet. I'll do it for you.
You can
punch it in if you want.
No,
I'm looking things here.
Yeah. I'm not math illiterate.
That's okay.
I was doing it in my head. As much as we joke on this show about me being a redneck, I actually am college educated.
I got thrown out.
Yeah, did you?
Yeah, making explosives on campus. That's a whole other story for another show.
Dude, now I'm totally getting high with this guy. Fuck. All right, so maybe you should have stayed.
I've never heard that one before.
Dude, I'm sure you haven't, dude. I am so sure. And look, if I didn't think you could take it, I wouldn't bust your ass.
That's all right.
Come on.
I mean, but anyway, how much money did you make
fucking playing video games?
Quite a bit.
Like, what's the average salary of somebody who was doing what you were doing per year?
Back in the day.
What was the day?
This was years ago. This was mid 90s.
Oh, so you were like Atari and shit. Did you fuck
up? No. That was back when. Do you know games at all?
Somewhat, yeah.
Doom 2 and the first Quake, Warcraft 2, stuff like that.
Okay, so how much does a guy like that make in the mid 90s?
Mid 90s, 50K, which was pretty good for the mid 90s.
That's huge in the mid 90s. Okay.
Yeah.
But they only make about that now because it's kind of a saturated market.
Well, yeah, now it's different. Now
it's not as.
You don't even get hired for that. Back then, there weren't a lot of people that actually played. You had these companies that made games and nobody played them, which is why I got hired on. Anyway,
go ahead.
When it comes to the curvature, we didn't make up this math. This is mainstream science math. We just said, okay, what shouldn't we be able to see over a body of water? Or, and again, I still like the salt flats, even though people say, well, the salt flats is just a flat piece of land on. Sorry, my voice is need water. Hang on. But it's 8 inches times every mile times itself, and. There are objects there. Yeah, the bottom will be cut off in some cases, but that's mostly atmospheric lensing. The point is, you shouldn't be able to see any of it, none of it, from a certain distance. And it's because it's on the other side of the hill.
Sarah Palin can see Russia from her house because the earth is flat.
Actually, Russia's pretty close.
Fuck you, Alex. High five, Alex. That's fucking rock shit.
But if the atmosphere wasn't there, if it was a vacuum, you would be able to see it.
It's also a refraction in the Earth's atmosphere. It's not like you're looking at things in a vacuum.
Is refraction going to give you a perfect image?
Fuck 8 inches a mile. Fuck a refraction. Fuck all that. All right. As we go on in society, science improves itself. And that's the beautiful thing about science. Science has no definite answer. This is pretty close to what we think, given on what we see. All right. And that's basically just a summary of science, because science is not definite. Science is not fact. Gravity is not proven.
Science tells you what is likely and what is unlikely.
Right,
it
exactly.
It doesn't tell you truth. It also can tell you what things are wrong.
Right. This is the best we can give you given on what we know.
I gotcha.
And that's basically what science says. And it will tell you that on what is likely and what is not likely.
It tells you what's likely and unlikely, but it also tells you what's wrong.
So
that it can tell you.
I don't know.
The Earth is not held up on the backs of an infinite progression of turtles, for instance.
The elephant's on the
turtle. I saw the fucking picture.
Although Mark might say different here.
No. Well, let me, before we go, can I throw one more little example? Let me throw a terrestrial example for you, because of what you were saying, what's likely and what's not likely. And that is, take any cross-section of the Earth. We all know, we've seen them since grade school. Cross-section of the Earth, it goes, you know, that red band, orange, yellow, white, you know, all that stuff, right? And if you believe in mainstream science, it's 4,000 miles to the center of the Earth, 8,000 miles all the way across, right? So 4,000 miles to the center. And you're saying, wow, that's really great. How do they know all this? What's the deepest hole ever drilled? Is it 2,000 miles? Is it 1,000 miles? What's the deepest probe we've ever sent? Is it 100 miles? Is it 10?
Yeah, but you don't have to drill a hole. Go ahead.
The deepest hole ever drilled is 8 miles. Ever is 8 miles.
Okay.
So the question is, how are you describing every single layer of Earth going all the way to the core if you've only drilled down 8 miles? Don't give me that seismic radar stuff or ground penetrating radar, because and even if that's the case, it's not going to be exact. Why isn't there any disclaimer on any of those cross sections on any science book that we've ever gotten? Until you go down there, what do you really know? And you're saying, what's your point? My point is, until you get up there, what do you really know? And once you go down there, are you going to rewrite all the science books? Yeah, you probably would if it was the core of the Earth, but if it's up above,
well, sure.
Probably not.
Well, we make a lot of assumptions based on best evidence and what we have, and then we revise those.
So,
those are why
so
they're
why
called
not,
theories. I mean,
so
you
why
revise
not
them
leave
as you
a,
go.
Why not leave a big question mark in the middle of the Earth? Why describe all these layers at perfect 1,000-mile intervals leading to this molten center, if you don't know, if you've only drilled down 8 miles?
What else? What are we assuming is down there, Mark? I mean, trolls living in the center?
No. That's my point, though. Science won't ever leave that. They won't leave. It's like they won't say, we don't know, because they hate having that question asked over again.
Oh, sure they do. They say that a hell of a lot more than religion people
fuck
do.
Fuck yeah. They don't know. This is the best educated guess we have at this moment, that cross-section of the Earth that we've seen since 1970, whatever the fuck. And I've seen it my whole life. And it has not changed. I'm with you, Mark. It has not changed since 1970, whatever. Yeah. I mean, it might have been modified slightly. Maybe a little bit.
Maybe. I don't think so, though.
Yeah, but I don't think it has changed.
I mean, if you go
back.
But
here's the thing. They don't fucking know this is their best.
No, I mean, there's a lot of things we don't know.
This is the most likely.
If you go back to the cosmic background radiation and you go back toward beyond T equals zero, if you try to go backwards beyond that, science will just say, we don't know. Here's our best theory of maybe, you know, through quantum mechanics, how this came about, blah, blah, blah. But they don't come right out and say, this is how it happened. They'll say, I don't know. Now, if you ask a religious person how that happened, God, they automatically fill in any unknown
with God.
I've
drank so
much
whiskey, I
gotta pee. How much time we got left? Do we have anything left, or are we done?
You got a few minutes if you'd like to have the last word.
Dude, I mean...
My last word is, for anyone out there, look, and I know, I don't know your audience, don't
they're all idiots.
Okay. Neither do we. Hey, just so you know, the DH podcast, DH stands for dickhead, and that's not...
Oh, is that what it stands for?
Yes, yeah, and that's not just the fucking three people sitting at the table. It's everyone who fucking decides.
Mark, you would know that if you listened to any of our prior shows, but see, you didn't. So now I'm disappointed in you.
Well, no. I deliberately don't nowadays, just so I can come in. I don't like to anticipate if I can help it. Were you guys out of?
Yeah,
right.
You probably would have said, well, fuck this.
Yeah, fuck that redneck.
I doubt it. Where are you guys located, though?
Chicago.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, perfect. The
not really.
Have you ever
that's
perfect.
Well, no, because the Chicago skyline, because that's one of the things in the community we talk about all the time.
It's a pretty nice skyline, just don't look down below it.
So again, when it comes to whatever I've said here, look, don't believe anything. Don't take my word for it. Don't take anybody's word. If you type in flat earth into YouTube and go through,
you are talking to the right people then.
Do your own research. Ask your own questions. Come to your own conclusions. because you're going to have a lot of them. And look, I can only tell you what happened to me and everybody else in the community. Everybody in the community started the same way, and that is, Flat Earth is a piece of crap. No one should ever believe in it. It should be ridiculed. It should be stomped into the ground. Fine.
I don't think it should be ridiculed, even though I have been doing that a little bit, but that's more busting your balls than anything.
It's natural. That's what everybody does. I literally was banging my head on the keyboard when I first looked at this thing because it couldn't. I was physically embarrassed to click on my first Flat Earth video. Physically flushed because I was going, and I couldn't figure out why. I was like, why am I embarrassed? I've looked at transvestite, alien, Bigfoot babies. You know, it's like, this shouldn't be anything big deal.
That sounds like my porn history.
Sounds like his search engine.
Delete your browser history, man.
And I'll get
the but at the same time, once you keep digging into it, I will end it with this, which is, if you like your life your way it is, you think you got a good beat on things, you get up in the morning, it's like, yep, I'm pretty sure I know what's what. Don't look into this. Don't open the box. Because once you open the box, if you look in long enough, you're not gonna be able to close it, and then you'll end up like me, you know, spouting out stuff and
right, going on idiot shows like this, trying to defend your position.
These fucking idiots,
Mark.
No, not at all. I enjoyed it.
Thanks for coming on.
Where are you from, Mark? By the way,
originally Seattle, Washington.
Oh, there's a lot of pot out there.
Now there is.
You live in Portland. If you say that, fuck you. I don't believe it.
No, but I was raised in Seattle, then I moved to Colorado, which is also
pot haven. This guy's full of shit.
For 20 years. No, I was never really did much for me compared to, I was one of those guys was looking for drugs, but no one would give them to me. Everyone said, don't give this guy drugs. And so no one ever did.
Oh, seriously, that was smart. Anyway. Could you imagine the shit you would believe if you did drugs? Oh.
Actually, I think wouldn't it be funny if he was more normal when he was on drugs? Yeah.
Smoke some weed and be like,
flat earth stuff's a bunch of shit.
Smoke some weed and be like, fuck, they were right. The earth is round. Shit. Fuck that redneck.
Mark, you've made my day.
Dude, day, Mark, honest to God, you are, this is my favorite show. And I've had some that were near and dear to my heart, like the Christians. I mean, that was a huge one for me. This is by far my favorite, and I do appreciate the way you take a beating, because I mean, we've given you one a little bit here. I do like you though. You're a smart guy. Honestly, I am gonna look a little bit into this. More for shits and giggles than
Can I do a 10-second plug?
Oh, please, go right ahead.
Please, your website, your Twitter name, whatever you want to give. Ahead.
Oh, sure. No, I don't even want to give out the website. Just make it easy for everybody. If you want to look what anyone's done in the community, just go into YouTube, type in Flat Earth. If you want my stuff, type in Flat Earth Clues, and you will find it. But there is a lot of stuff out there.
Okay.
All right.
Have fun. Yeah. Hey, we're here to push your. As crazy as we may think it is, we're here to push your fucking agenda. I mean, share it with everybody. Maybe one of our listeners jump on your bandwagon and go, and you can take them with you when you leave then, brother. So,
nice.
It was a good time, man. I'm just fucking with you.
No, it's okay.
Definitely if you and I are ever in the same area, I would so love to hang out with you. I'm not a dick all the time. Well, actually, I am a dick all the time.
Yeah, you kind of are.
Yeah. So, all right. But it's all in good fun, dude. I appreciate you coming on the show. I appreciate you being that cool. And I thank you so much for all the information, in spite of its lack of authenticity.
Thanks,
nice
Mark.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you coming on.
I'm going to go slam my head into the computer now. Bye.
Okay. All right. Bye-bye, guys.
Take care.
Bye.
All right.